Please see the link in the description to download a worksheet for this video. Experiments can be dangerous. If you are a child, never do experiments unless your parent, guardian, or adult educator says it's all right and is there with you the whole time. Have you ever wondered what makes the tides rise and fall? Or why is the sky blue? Scientists wondered those same questions. Then they used the scientific method to discover the answers. In this video, we will give an overview of the scientific method. In other videos in this mini-series, we will show several examples of how to design various experiments and how to graph the results. Although scientists have made the scientific method famous, it is also used by individual businesses when they want to do an experiment to solve a business question they have. For example, here is a typical test question based on an experiment a small business did. Questions about the scientific method are very common on state exams for all grades. Typical questions will include those asking you to interpret graphs like these. Learning how to plot graphs from data and tables will be a major focus in this video mini-series. State exams may also ask you what is the right way to set up an experiment. Once you know a few basic principles, you can answer those questions easily. We will review those principles in this mini-series. Once you know the right way to make an experiment and how to interpret the results, then you will be able to recognize flawed experiments that others do. This can be helpful in your job and also how you make personal decisions. There are many different lists that have different names and number of steps for the scientific method. We made a simple list with just 4 steps, and you can remember these because when you take the first letter of each step, they spell the word data. Data is a word that scientists use to mean information. And information is the key to answering any questions, including the questions about nature that scientists ask. Now, let's expand each word for the 4 steps. Step 1. Decide on a question you want to research. Step 2. Arrange the question as a hypothesis. Step 3. Test your hypothesis with an experiment. Step 4. Analyze and publish your experiment's results. Next, we'll give a little more explanation for each of these steps. We start by picking a topic that is interesting to us. It could be about anything in nature. For example, let's say we're interested in knowing how plants grow. The word plants includes trees, grass, and flowers. Next, we ask a specific question. We might have a question based on something we noticed or a conversation we had with a friend. Or we could try to answer a famous unanswered question that other scientists are also trying to answer. Let's say we have noticed that the grass and a lot of trees do not seem to grow much in the winter. So we want to know if a plant's temperature affects whether a plant will grow. Our specific question for a research experiment should have a yes or no answer. Questions that start with how or why or what will not work for science experiments. The reason is because in the next step of the scientific method, we will arrange this question as a hypothesis, and a hypothesis can only be true or false. We can only answer science questions that start with what, how, and why once we or other scientists have done many research experiments and are then able to summarize those results. Our research question could be, does grass grow faster when its temperature is above 20 degrees Celsius? Before we spend time and possibly money doing an experiment, we search to see if a scientist has already answered this question. There are many places to search online. These are often called databases, since data means information. A famous database is this U.S. government site with millions of technical pages that we can quickly search through. After we enter a few words, the website then searches through the entire database to find research articles that contain all of these words. Then we can look at any of these articles as a brief summary, or even look at the full article without ever having to go to a library. We might find that nobody has answered this question in detail, so we decide to do research on this. Now, we go to the next step, which is to arrange the question as a hypothesis. To do that, we make a guess as to what's the correct answer to the question, then state that answer. Based on our experience, we might guess that plants only grow when their temperature is above freezing, which is 0 degrees Celsius. So, our hypothesis for this experiment is Grass grows faster when its temperature is above 20 degrees Celsius. It's entirely fine if we guessed wrong. The important thing is to have a hypothesis so that we can design the study properly. When we're first learning how to design studies and graph the results, it helps to put the word depends in our hypothesis. In other videos in this mini-series, we will demonstrate why using the word depends can be so helpful in designing an experiment and graphing the results. For now, let's rewrite the hypothesis with the word depends. Fast grass growth depends on a temperature that is above 20 degrees Celsius. Here's a review of this step, which is to arrange the question as a hypothesis. First, we started with this question from the prior step. It is a question with an answer that is either yes or no. Then we answered that question with our best guess. Finally, we arranged the question as a statement with our best guess as the answer, and the statement includes the word depends. In the test step, we run the experiment. We have two groups of grass. One is called the control group, and the other is called the experimental group. Both groups have the same type of grass and get the same amount of light and water. But the control group's temperature will be kept at 30 degrees Celsius, whereas the experimental group's temperature will be kept at 10 degrees Celsius. At the end of 4 weeks, we measure the average height and find it is 40 centimeters for the control group and 20 centimeters for the experimental group. The last step of the scientific method is to analyze and publish our results. In elementary and middle school, we analyze our results by graphing our results, then looking at the graph to spot trends. We can see that warmer grass appear to grow faster. This would suggest that our hypothesis is correct. The final part of this step, and the entire scientific method, is to share our results. And sharing results at a scientific conference is a great way to meet other scientists. Then, we publish our results in a scientific journal that looks like this. This happens to be the most famous journal in medicine. Every research study gets its own article in which the researchers describe their hypothesis, exactly how they designed the study, the results with the data displayed in tables and as graphs, and their conclusion about whether their hypothesis was right or wrong. No research experiment is ideal, so researchers describe the parts that were not ideal as limits, so someone else might be able to do a better job. If we publish our results in a journal like this, then other scientists will find it when they search a database, like we did in the second step. The journals are also bound as big books and kept in libraries like this one. To summarize, here are the four basic steps of the scientific method. We often write these as a circle to show that as we learn the answer to one question, then we ask another question and repeat the cycle. Many people become scientists because they are fascinated by nature and curious about how nature works. Many scientists have hypotheses and discoveries that may seem impractical when they are first shared. For example, about 100 years ago, Albert Einstein had many ideas that led to discoveries about nature, but seemed to be of no use until recently when people started using GPS to find their way on land, at sea, or in planes. But the entire GPS system relies on satellites that work, because engineers used facts about nature that Albert Einstein helped discover over 100 years ago, which at the time seemed to have no practical use. The Nobel Prize is one of the most famous prizes for discoveries or the development of an important method.
Jennifer Doudna, the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences, has decided to award you the 2020 Nobel Prize in Chemistry to you for the development of a method for genome editing. It is a great honor to convey to you my warmest congratulations and ask you to receive the Nobel Prize.
Here's a summary of the topic we just covered. Please pause the video to read this if you wish. We thank the University of California, Berkeley for permission to use video of Professor Doudna. Please see the link in the description for the original video. Please subscribe if you'd like to be notified of future educational videos we make. Thanks for your attention.